Speaking Volumes by Gordon Griffin. Narrated by Gordon Griffin. Introduction. The envelope looked very official. Too official. It could only be some sort of bill or bad news. I put it on my desk and ignored it. A couple of days later, I picked it up and stared at it. I made myself an espresso and said, "This is ridiculous. By not opening it, I'm putting off any bad news that it might contain." I took a swig of coffee and opened it. I read the first sentence, once, twice, and then let out a yell. My partner, who was in the other room, dashed in to see if I was okay. Was I having a heart attack? I handed the letter over. "Does it say what I think it says? I'm not going mad, am I?" The letter was from the Cabinet Office and was asking if I'd accept an MBE in the upcoming Queen's Birthday Honours List. The letter was very formal and made it quite clear that the contents were top secret. I wasn't to tell anyone until the day before it was officially announced. How had this happened? How had a fishmonger's son, growing up in the Northeast in the 1950s, been offered such an honour? I knew it was because of my having recorded so many audiobooks, at that point over 750, and this was my reward. But how had that little Geordie lad become the person who had recorded more audiobooks than anyone else in Europe? How did I get to this point? From biker to Buckingham Palace? This is the story of that journey. Part 1. Getting There. Chapter 1. The teacher, Miss Karen, I think her name was standing in for the regular teacher who was on maternity leave. She was discussing what we would like to do when we leave school. This was a secondary modern school. Although I was well above average at English, I was hopeless at maths, and to pass the 11 plus, you needed to be at least average at both. I failed. I was pretty bright, and my teachers at junior school had great expectations, but I had been told very early on in my school life that I was useless at maths, and it was true that when I saw a batch of numbers, my brain went blank. Miss Karen asked each of us in turn what we'd like to do when we left school. The girls wanted to be hairdressers or secretaries, the boys bricklayers or carpenters. She came to me. "And Gordon, what would you like to be?" I didn't hesitate. I answered, "I want to be an actor, miss." There was a very long pause. "An actor?" she repeated. "Yes, miss, or a priest." I have no idea why I said that. I just felt that saying I wanted to be an actor was somehow the wrong answer. I certainly didn't want to be a priest, but I was in the church choir and enjoyed the performance element of that. Being above the audience congregation, wearing cassock, ruffle and a white surplice, we choir boys were there to support the priest. His costume was much showier, and he had a better part, so I suppose I was thinking of being a priest as a variation of being an actor. A priest? She was intrigued. "Well, not really a priest, miss." I suddenly was not going to be intimidated. "An actor?" Miss Karen wasn't the only person to react in this way. The idea of a Geordie boy, yes, with a Geordie accent, wanting to be an actor in the mid-1950s, was so unlikely as to be ridiculous. To start with, to be a serious actor, you needed to have no accent, to have a BBC voice with received pronunciation. This was before Albert Finney, Tom Courtney and co. made Northern accents acceptable, but quite a long time before Geordie became acceptable or even recognised. I don't remember ever wanting to be anything else. From the first time I was taken to a pantomime, I was hooked. I didn't want to be in the dark auditorium. I wanted to be on stage in the bright lights. That's where the fun was happening. I envied the children in the show, the local dance school presumably, and wanted to be up there with them. There was one problem. I was painfully shy. So when Buttons or Idle Jack called for kids to come up on stage, I was much too self-conscious to go up. The point is, I wanted to be on stage, but not as me, but as a villager or a page boy in Cinderella. But from the first time I went into a theatre, and I was very young indeed, I felt an urge so strong to be part of this world, and I never lost that urge. Incidentally, the first panto I saw was Babes in the Wood at the long-demolished Grand Theatre, Biker. According to my mother, they had real Northumbrian sheep on stage. I can't remember that, of course. Maybe she was pulling the wool over my eyes. But why did I want to be an actor? I don't know. My maternal granddad was a miner at Brandon Colliery in County Durham. He was self-educated, highly intelligent, and a voracious reader. Not only did he have the complete works of Shakespeare and Shaw, but he could and did quote great chunks from the plays. There is no question that my mother inherited her love of words from him. She was a shy girl who escaped into her books, Charlotte Bronte and Dickens, and her beloved Keats. She also wrote poetry. She didn't understand music, although she enjoyed singing. She'd often say, "Words are my music." Like her father, my mother could recite reams of poetry. If ever in later years I wanted to know where a particular line of poetry came from, I'd phone her up, and she almost always knew. So the love of words came from my mother. But where did the performance gene come from? My dad had a pleasant singing voice and would sing in his laid-back style at Christmas parties, but he had to be persuaded. He was not a natural performer. His father, who died before I was born, had once auditioned for the Carl Rosa Opera Company, or so it was claimed, but presumably he wasn't successful, because he ended up running first one and then three fish shops, where the scales he had to deal with were rather different from those of a singer. So the question, why an actor, has no satisfactory answer. But there was no doubt at all that I wanted to be an actor, and I never wavered from that desire. An interesting detour. My mother's maiden name was Paulin, a name I'd very seldom heard. The only Paulin I'd come across was the poet Tom Paulin, and he clearly was no relation, as he has a delightful Northern Irish accent. I used to watch him on the now-defunct Friday night Newsnight review show on BBC Two. He had a wry take on things, and a delightful twinkle. While other contributors were rather po-faced about, say, the ABBA musical Mamma Mia, Tom would slide further into his chair and say in his languid, drawn-out accent, "Well, I rather liked it." One day, they were reviewing our Wiedersehen Pet, the series where the original cast got together years after the success of the original programmes. I was amazed and excited to hear Tom Paulin say that he loved the Geordie accent because his dad had come from the Northeast. What? Surely, if his dad was a Paulin, there must be a connection to my mum's family. The name is so uncommon. I wrote to Tom and mentioned my mother's cousin, who was a well-known clergyman in the area, whose first name I couldn't remember. Tom's reply was charming, but he didn't know the answer to my questions. However, he sent my letter to his father, who was still alive and lived in Northern Ireland. Tom's father was also the cousin of the clergyman, and he was able to provide his name, Leonard. So my mother and Tom's father were cousins. I was, therefore, related to Tom Paulin. And how appropriate that Tom Paulin is a poet. Words, words, words. Sadly, by the time I received this information, my mother was dead. How thrilled she would have been. Now, I watched the review programme with a new interest and saw straight away something I'd not realised previously. Tom Paulin was the spitting image of my granddad, my mum's dad, who died when I was 14. I was born in Gilsland, on the Northumberland-Cumberland border. I was the firstborn child of my parents, and they lived in a flat in the centre of Newcastle, in a delightful street, Chester Crescent. As the war was on, and as Newcastle was frequently bombed, some mothers were whisked away from the city to have their babies away from the bombing. Gilsland is an interesting place. It's a village on the Roman Wall and was a popular spa in its heyday. A splendid hotel attracted visitors who'd come to take the rather sulphurous waters and walk in the beautiful countryside. In 1797, Walter Scott came. He mentions Gilsland in one of his novels, to look for a wife, and he found one. That hotel eventually closed its doors and became variously a convalescent home and, during the war, a maternity hospital. It's where I was born. It was also the birthplace of the tragic figure Andy Nielsen, Ruth Ellis's son. Ruth Ellis was, of course, the last woman to be hanged in this country. My dad was the second of five sons. My grandfather left shops in his will to the three oldest sons, Cuthbert, Bill, my dad, and Tommy. As my dad was fighting for king and country, my mum and grandmother ran two of the fish shops. So, as well as bringing up me, and later my brother, my mother was working a full day in the shops. When I became a toddler, I was installed in a nursery for part of the day. I loved it. I played the piano there and loved the singing and games. When VIPs came to visit the nursery, I'd be chosen to present the flowers. Music was to play a very important part in my life, and even after I'd forgotten the plots of television programmes or films, I'd remember the theme music. Likewise, I can still sing some of those songs I sang at the nursery, even though I've not heard them since, and it's over 70 years since I sang them. I was apparently a bonny, blue-eyed, rosy-cheeked little boy. I'd embarrass my mum, though, when we were on the bus. I'd smile at everyone who got on and say, "My daddy's in the army," and my poor mum had to refuse as kindly as possible the money the little old ladies wanted to give the canny lad. When I was six, we moved from our flat in Heaton. We had moved nearer to my dad's shop, to Whitley Bay. My mum, who'd worked in hotels in Newcastle and London, wanted to open a boarding house and run it like a small hotel. The house had seven bedrooms and pretty soon was open for business. It was a huge success from the start, and for the 10 years that the guest house was open, it was always full from May to September. In those days, before we all zipped across to Spain for our holidays, Whitley Bay was a very popular destination for holidaymakers. During the fair fortnight, when the Glasgow shipyards closed down, thousands would descend on Whitley Bay and the Murray guest house was packed. My mother worked incredibly hard, but loved it. During the summer, my brother Andy and I lived in an annex at the back of the house, and having the house full of visitors didn't affect our lives much. When I was eight, I started piano lessons. Before that, I'd just picked up tunes or improvised. Now I was taught by my Auntie Molly, a formidable teacher. I loved playing the piano, but hated practicing scales, although fairly soon I learned how to sight read. While we had our summer visitors in the house, I couldn't get to the piano to practice, so had to pop a few streets away to my grandmother's, my dad's mum, where I could play and sing to my heart's content. One day, though, at home, when the guests were having their lunch in the dining room, I sneaked into the lounge to play. I realised, of course, that the diners would be able to hear me, so I always made sure I played a selection of Scottish songs to end my recital. My mother was wary and tried to stop me, but the guests insisted I play, so it became a regular feature. I had an audience, even though they were in a different room. And I seem to remember, even though I pleaded that I didn't want anything and meant it, I made quite a bit in tips too. There's a theme here. My first school in Whitley Bay was Rockliffe Infants, immortalised in The Likely Lads. Ian Lefrenay, one of the writers, was from Whitley Bay. I was joining the school at the age of seven, having started my schooling, before our move, at Sandyford Road School in the heart of Newcastle. I was to be thrust into a world that was new, with pupils and teachers who knew each other, but didn't know me. Before I started school, my mother, brother and I were invited with other parents to a performance by the children in the school hall. This consisted of movement and song. I don't remember the content, but I do remember that it was lively and colourful, and that I wanted to be at a school where they did such things. Rockcliffe School is still there, bold and imposing, and it seems to be doing very well, if Ofsted ratings are anything to go by. The infant school was on the ground floor, and the juniors on the floor above. And it was the juniors that I remember so well. At one PTA meeting, the pupils put on a show. It consisted of a dramatisation of the song The Raggle Taggle Gypsies-O. I was one of the three gypsies. It was my first performance in front of an audience, and I loved it. But I felt very aggrieved that Peter Taylor was given the better part of the prince. Still, I was in it, and I loved the experience. We had an inspirational teacher in Miss Smith. She was an archetypal teacher of the period. Grey hair pulled into a tight bun on the top of her head, tweed suits and sensible shoes. She was my class teacher in my final year at junior school. So I was lucky that I was, even then, fantasising about being an actor, even though I didn't really quite know what being an actor meant, because Miss Smith loved music and the theatre. The school went to plays done by the Arena Theatre Company in Newcastle, which I admit were rather dull. But we once, amazingly, went to the wonderful Theatre Royal in Newcastle to see a show about putting on a play. A well-known actress was the presenter, and I remember one of the tricks of the trade she demonstrated was how a fully laid dining table could be set up within minutes. The empty table and chairs were on the stage, the curtain dropped, and very quickly it rose again, showing a fully laden table with people in evening dress sitting around it, drinking and laughing. The trick, of course, was the settings were already laid out on a board the size of the tabletop, which was simply placed on the empty table. To me, it was magical. I've not forgotten it. And I'm still mystified as to why we went to see such a show and why a theatre company thought it would be of interest to Geordie kids. Miss Smith was also the school's music teacher. Every morning she'd get us to sing the second part of the song, Early One Morning. Oh, don't deceive me. Oh, never leave me. How could you use a poor maiden so? She reckoned those musical phrases were more interesting than singing scales. Every morning we would sing those lines, never the opening of the song. I was always fascinated by words. I loved English. I loved writing. I made up stories and plays and wrote them in an exercise book. I wanted to do real writing or joined-up writing, and before we were taught how to do it, I just joined the printed letters together. Suddenly, I was no longer just printing the letters. I enjoyed the physicality of writing, dipping the pen into the ink and writing as neatly as I could on the clean white paper. At the time, there was a publication called The Children's Newspaper. It had a competition for schools, and selected pupils had to copy a paragraph in their neatest handwriting. I was chosen as one of those representing my school. Our headmaster was well named, Mr. Hardman. He was dour and terrifying, or so he seemed to us pupils. One morning during assembly, we were all sitting cross-legged on the floor in the hall. After we'd sung the morning hymn, played with enthusiasm by the aforementioned Miss Smith, Mr. Hardman came to the lectern to address us. I was shocked and appalled when he said, in his sternest voice, "Would Gordon Griffin please come here?" indicating the dais on which he stood. I was extremely embarrassed as I nervously made my way to the front of the assembled children. My face was burning and I was shaking with fear. Mr. Hardman, still unsmiling, pointed to me and addressed his audience. "This is Gordon Griffin." Was he going to cane me in front of all the school? What had I done that was so terrible? "He has made our school proud." I couldn't believe my ears. What was happening? He continued, "Gordon has won the Children's Newspaper Handwriting Competition." I remember the huge feeling of relief, rather than the pride I should have felt, as everyone applauded, children and teachers alike. I think that the school received some cash prize, but I got a rather handsome blue certificate. My mother had it framed. I still have it. It was around this time that I made my first proper performance on a stage. As I mentioned before, I was in the church choir. St. Paul's Church in the centre of Whitley Bay has been there almost as long as the town has. My brother, also a chorister, and myself would be there for early service, encouraged by our mother. For the early service, we just wore cassocks. The white robe was surplus to requirements. But then we wore the full works for the sung family service at 9 o'clock each Sunday. We had to traipse back around 6 o'clock for evensong. To make matters worse, we also were enrolled at the Sunday school in St. Paul's Church Hall. One day at Sunday school, I was saying the responses to the prayers when a jolly woman came up to me. "You know all the words without referring to your prayer book?" She seemed impressed. I explained that I was in the choir, so yes, I knew them. And then she asked if I'd like to be in the nativity play that was to be performed by children from the Sunday school on the stage of the church hall. The part was one of the kings. Would I? I remember even now the thrill and excitement I felt. My grandmother made me a robe from an old dressing gown and sewed faux ermine at the edges. A cardboard crown was painted gold with bits of glitter. I remember nothing of the rehearsals, but I do remember being on stage with a large, live audience. It was thrilling. I must have been conscientious learning my lines, because I can still recite my first long speech. I loved being up there under the bright lights. But of course, after I'd said my piece and presented my gift of gold to the baby Jesus, I had a bit of standing around to do. On the first night, my family was in the audience, and so was Pat, a girl I was trying to impress. When I wasn't involved in the action, I'd give her little surreptitious waves. No one would notice. Of course, everyone noticed and started to laugh. I still didn't realise until afterwards, when my mother said how much she'd enjoyed my performance. "But perhaps tomorrow night you should cut down on the waving." Chapter 2. As I mentioned before, I was way above average at English, but I was useless at maths, or arithmetic, as we called it then. Every morning, after we'd sung the second half of Early One Morning, Miss Smith would give us 10 mental arithmetic questions to get our brains in gear for the day's work. Somewhere in the past, I'd been told I was useless at sums, and I had a blockage. I don't think I ever got more than about 4 sums right, ever. I was still working out the first one while Miss Smith was rattling through the test. Useless. I think I was pretty bright, but I was innumerate. Words were my thing. To pass the 11+, though, you had to be at least average at English and maths. Well, clearly, I was well above average at one and well below average at the other. Nevertheless, my parents were told that I would pass easily. The teachers were confident. But I failed. I remember being pleased at how easy the English section was. I even remember the story I wrote. The exam paper gave a sentence, and we had to use that sentence to start a story. Mine was about a man leaving prison and adjusting to life on the outside. But that essay didn't save me. Michael Morpurgo wrote movingly recently about the humiliation he felt when he failed his 11+. I too was mortified and embarrassed, and I know my parents were very disappointed. I do believe I was clever enough to go to the local grammar school, except in that one subject, where I was useless. So I'd be signalled out as a failure, aged 11, as I strolled around the town in my brown school blazer rather than the nice blue one that the grammar school boys wore. It was tough for my parents, who had expected more. They'd even sent me to a coach to improve my arithmetic. It was a waste of money. I had a mental block with numbers. Incidentally, I recently read in Peter Davison's autobiography, which I recorded, that not only he, Davison, but also Daniel Craig and Colin Firth were 11+ failures. In my first year at Park School, I did at least get a good part in the school play. The director and writer was a teacher, Douglas Maitland, who was involved in drama in the county. It was an interesting play about a teacher taking her pupils around a theatre where a company is rehearsing a production, Shaw's St. Joan. There is a drama going on off stage as the temperamental director, played by Sammy Padmore, who later went on to write plays, realises that the actress playing Joan can't perform. The teacher takes over with great success. So the second part of the play, which had many titles but ended up being called Amateurs How Interesting, is the trial scene from Shaw's play. Sandra Wright, I think that was her name, was astonishing as Joan. I remember all these years later the power of her performance. I played the sympathetic brother Martin. I was in my element. I devoured plays. In those far-off days, the Whitley Bay Library was in a series of rooms above the bus station in the centre of the town. As soon as I was old enough, I became a member and was so proud of my library card. I felt so grown up. I even recall the first book I took out, Alice Through the Looking Glass, a book I was to produce in audiobook form many years later. But it was the plays section I devoured. I read every play I could get my hands on. I also borrowed music scores, mostly of musicals. I couldn't wait to rush home and play through the songs or act out the plays for my own pleasure. But I knew that that wasn't enough. I wanted an audience. I had a puppet theatre with an assortment of puppets. I'd make up plays using the puppets, practising the different voices. I painted scenery. I made up songs. I was ready to give a performance for my friends. I went around telling my neighbours and friends that I'd be giving a performance in the annex of our house. I set out enough seating and even bought bars of chocolate and packets of sweets and crisps to sell before and after the show. I was all set up. All I needed to do now was to wait for my friends and neighbours to arrive at the appointed time to see the show. I waited and waited and waited. Not one person turned up. I even went dashing around to chase up friends who lived nearby. But no one came. Of course, I was very disappointed. My mother was very sympathetic. I think for the first time she took my passion for the theatre and for performing seriously. She recognised that if I wanted to be an actor, then I needed to do something about my Geordie accent. She contacted an elocution teacher who lived a few streets away, Sylvia Blair, and after a meeting with her, I enrolled. Miss Blair was a very attractive woman in her 20s. Her classes were held in a room on the first floor of her parents' terraced house in, appropriately, Gordon Square. The room was bright and empty of all but basic furniture, and the walls were covered with her certificates and diplomas. I liked her from the start. I soon became her star pupil, and when she had performances in the local church halls, I get the best scenes or the most telling poems to perform. The classes always started with me having to read a list of words. I soon learned to pronounce pass, and not with a flat A to rhyme with crass. I became bilingual, Geordie and non-Geordie. Of course, I couldn't talk about having a bath with my schoolmates. I'd be lynched. It was bath to rhyme with cath. Slowly, I was able to talk quite naturally without the accent, although the accent was still there under the surface. I imagine if you're English but have grown up with a French mother and speak both languages from being a baby, then that is what I was like with my Geordie. Quite soon, I was being entered for national exams in acting and verse speaking. I always received high marks, and my mother didn't know what to do with all the certificates I received. I was pleased about the prizes, only because they so pleased my mother and Miss Blair. I was always a little envious of the actor Jeremy Spencer. He was a similar age to me, and he played all the parts I wanted to play on stage in London's West End and on film. He'd been playing the boy king in Terence Rattigan's comedy The Sleeping Prince that starred Vivian Leigh and her then-husband Laurence Olivier. Miss Blair heard that one of the top amateur companies in the Northeast was doing a production of it in Newcastle and encouraged me, I didn't need much encouragement, to go and read for the Jeremy Spencer part. In the meantime, my grandmother had read in the local paper that the director of the nearby weekly repertory theatre company at Tynemouth was looking for local child actors to be in a play set in a public school. The play was Housemaster by Ian Hay. I went to meet the director, Douglas Emery, and read for him in his tiny dressing room, no more than a cupboard backstage at the Plaza Theatre. I remember that wonderful backstage smell of paint and sawdust and cigarette smoke and disinfectant. It was magical. I read for the Boy King for the amateur company in Newcastle. There were lots of others for the role, and I remember stumbling over the words as I read. I was nervous. I was sure I'd not get the part. Sylvia Blair phoned me up excitedly to say that they wanted me to do the Ratigan. Just before she'd called, I'd taken a call from Douglas Emery, the Tynemouth director, who wanted me to play the main boy, Bimbo Farringdon, in Housemaster. Sylvia was adamant. I should do the Sleeping Prince. But in my mind, there was no contest. Tynemouth was a professional company. I'd be playing a very good part with real live actors, and I was to get paid £1 a week. That was £2 in total. 1 week's rehearsal and 1 week playing. It was to be done in the Easter holiday, so the school couldn't object. So in April 1956, the curtain went up on me as Bimbo Farringdon. I was a professional actor. I would never look back. It was the most exciting couple of weeks of my life so far. I loved the rehearsal, the learning of the lines, the getting on the bus at the top of my street and getting off at the stage door of the imposing Plaza Theatre overlooking the sea. I was an actor. The cast were so nice to me, friendly and warm and helpful. This was really my first time on a proper stage, and I was a professional. It was a heady time. I was dizzy with the excitement of it all. Even the school made a fuss when I returned after the Easter break. There was an article in the local paper about me. Friends, family and teachers came to support me. Even Sylvia came, although she still thought I ought to have done the Sleeping Prince. Douglas Emery was pleased, as I'd received a couple of good reviews, and later that year, again, to coincide with the school holidays, I received my second part. This time, I was a newsboy, not much to do, but I didn't care. I was welcomed back. I was part of the family. Although it was a weekly rep company, the standard of acting and production was very good. I went to the late afternoon matinee every Saturday and often went backstage to see my colleagues. It was all very grown up. Later, I rejoined the company to do a pantomime and then a farce. It was at that point that my headmaster put his foot down. I must stop the play acting and get down to schoolwork. In the third year at Park School, a new teacher joined the staff, Mr. Turnbull. He was the English teacher and was particularly interested in drama. One day we had a break from lessons and could read whatever book we wanted. At one point he strolled round the classroom to see what we were reading. I was reading Under Milk Wood. He seemed surprised. "Are you actually reading this?" he'd asked, which I thought was an odd question. I told him that I certainly was. We had an hour's lesson every week that was called drama. Quite early on, he asked me to perform something during the hour. I got some malleable friends together, and we put on a play. It was a success. I made sure there were a lot of jokes in it, and from that day on, the drama hour was mine. I still find it incredible that Mr. Turnbull allowed me to do that. Too lazy to work out what to do himself? I really don't think so. It was a wonderful experience for me. I always played the lead, of course, and I wrote the plays, mostly improvised. There wasn't time to write scripts or learn lines. And I made sure they were funny, often pinching gags from workers' playtime on the radio, which I used to listen to during my school lunch breaks at home. In 2015, I was giving a talk about my career as an audiobook reader to a thankfully packed Whitley Bay Library audience. The library was no longer a few rooms above the bus station, but a smart new glass building. The talk, which by then was tried and tested, went very well. I had friends and family in the audience, and afterwards They gathered round to chat and ask questions. I knew an old school pal, whom I had not seen for years, was coming, so I'd brought some school photos with me to show him. Then, behind the group crowding around the table, I saw a small, elderly man hovering shyly in the background. I knew at once who it was, even after nearly 60 years. It was Mr. Turnbull. I leapt up to shake his hand. He was all smiles. It was so wonderful to see him. Coincidentally, a couple of the school photos I brought with me had him in them, so I showed him and his wife pictures of himself that he'd not seen before. I asked him why he'd let me have the drama hour to do as I wished. It still mystified me. He seemed surprised by the question. But why wouldn't I? You did it so well. I was still mystified. But of course it was wonderful for me. And, as they told me years later, my fellow pupils enjoyed those sessions too. Talking to my school friends all those years later after my talk, there was one common thread. They all knew that I would make a success in the theatre. That was surprising to hear, but heartening somehow. I knew it myself, but it was interesting that others felt the same, especially given the time and the place and my background. Actors lived in London. They spoke posh. They didn't live in the northeast and have Geordie accents. In all the excitement of seeing Mr. Turnbull again, I didn't get his contact details or a photo on my phone. But I was so happy to be able to tell him face to face how important a part he had played in my life at that time, and how important his encouragement was when all the other teachers and the headmaster thought I was wasting my time and should be preparing for a life outside school where I would get a proper job. A few months ago, I got a friend's request on Facebook. It was from Mr. Turnbull. I was thrilled to be in touch with him again.
Chapter 3. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.